cryptography is used in many areas and many applications that we use every day. It's used, for instance, to authenticate people to have access to bank accounts. So if you make some payment with a credit card, you're using cryptography. If you have a biometric passport to go through a border, you're using cryptography. You can use cryptography also to unlock your car with a wireless key. If you use a cell phone also, you're using cryptography quite a lot because you have communication over the radio channel and you don't want anyone to be able to understand your communication. So cryptography is used in many areas for communication, mostly to protect confidentiality and to authenticate.
This was Professor Serge Rodney of the IC School at EPFL, and it's interesting to stress the two fundamental aspects of cryptography that he mentioned. On one hand, we have the protection of confidentiality. Typically, if you're sending a message through the internet or when you received a message through the internet, you don't want the message to be intercepted. To do so, cryptography will blur the message in some way, so that nobody else can read it. But another, perhaps less known but equally important application of cryptography is authentication. When someone sends you a message, your web service will probably want to deliver it to you and not to someone who tries to steal your identity. And to do so, your web service is going to ask you to authenticate yourself, and you can use cryptography to do so. Authentication is also fundamental to web transactions, like for instance in the Bitcoin technology, because obviously you don't want an identity thief to steal your identity and spend your money. However, there are still many open questions in cryptography. For one thing, the rise of quantum computers is a real threat to current cryptography technologies.
So far, what we can break dramatically using quantum computers are most of the public key cryptographic algorithms that we are using. So all those which are based on the discrete logarithm problem, or those which are based on the factoring problem, they will all be broken by quantum computers. So for this, we need some replacement.
We talked about the discrete logarithm problem in a previous video on the Diffie-Hellman protocol. Very briefly, the problem consists in determining x if we only know d to the power x, where d is some element of some large finite group. The details do not matter. The thing is that in 1994, Peter Shor proved that quantum computers were able to solve the discrete logarithm problem in an efficient manner. And this means that quantum computers can break nearly all of current classical asymmetric cryptography.
For asymmetric cryptography, so most of the schemes are broken by quantum computers. And that's why people now work on other alternate solutions. So they want to find some other kind of one-way problem, but there are not so many candidates. So far we know the problem of the discrete logarithm problem. We know also schemes which are based on a factoring problem. So that's a problem when you have two numbers and we multiply them together. So it's easy to do in one direction. But in the other direction, it's something which is so far hard to do on a classical computer, but which will be easy on a quantum computer. So we know these two problems, and most of the public key cryptographic schemes are based on these two problems, and we know they will all be broken by quantum computers. So that's why people try to find other candidates for hard problems, hard one-way problems, and to build cryptographic schemes based on these problems.
However, this does not mean that all of classical cryptography will have to be thrown away. Recall that here we are talking about asymmetric cryptography, which, as we discussed previously, is mostly used to set up a secure communication channel, which will then run symmetric cryptography. Fortunately, it seems that even with quantum computers out there, symmetric cryptography, if it can be set up, will remain safe.
If we use a key which is large enough, it will be safe, even with a quantum computer, to use symmetric cryptography.
So there you have it. If you want to make a huge breakthrough in cryptography, just invent a new asymmetric classical cryptography and prove that quantum computers cannot break it. Now, if asymmetric cryptography is not your thing, there may be another way for you to make a huge breakthrough in cryptography, especially nowadays as big data and privacy are becoming more and more hot topics.
Something which is pretty hot is how to secure databases, and in particular, how to secure data which is stored in clouds. So now people store all their data in clouds, but they still want to have privacy, so they want to store it in private way.
Now, technically, this can already be done with current open source technologies.
But it has to be efficient, so if they want to retrieve some information, they don't want to download all what they store and then to decrypt and search for what they are interested in.
Imagine you had gigabytes, terabytes, maybe even zettabytes of data out there on the cloud. And imagine you're searching for one very particular piece of information on the cloud. You don't want to have to download all of your data every time you're searching for a single piece of information in all of your data in the cloud. It would take a lot of time and it would consume a huge amount of energy if everybody did that. So what you want to do is to
do some search in a cloud, even though the data is encrypted. So we need some way to efficiently search through encrypted data.
But this sounds impossible.
We need also ways to sort data, to make queries to databases, even though the data can be encrypted.
Again, this sounds impossible.
We want also to do, so, in more general way, to do some computation over data which is encrypted without having to decrypt it.
But how could you search through encrypted data? Isn't the point of cryptography to prevent you from searching through any encrypted data? Turns out that cryptography theorists are pretty smart. They've designed
what we call the homomorphic encryption. So we need some encryption which makes possible to compute addition on encrypted data, multiplication on encrypted data, so that we can do any calculation.
Homomorphic encryption. This sounds so cool. The idea here is based on exploiting very cool mathematical concepts invented over 100 years ago. Namely, mathematicians have explored the similarities between mathematical structures. For instance, this square shares similarities with numbers up to 4, in the sense that performing a 90-degree rotation of the square is similar to adding 1 to the numbers up to 4, with the weird convention that says that 4 is equal to 0. And this means that rotations of the squares can be performed by only manipulating numbers. We say that there is a homomorphism that transforms rotations of the square into operations of numbers up to 4. Similarly, we may want to perform some operation to our real decrypted data like addition. However, we may want to leave our data encrypted on the cloud. So instead, homomorphic encryption will translate the addition we want to perform on decrypted data into a weird cryptic operation on encrypted data. Crucially, in the end, we can download only the encrypted result, we can then decrypt it, and this will give the same result as the one we would obtain had we first downloaded the whole database and performed the addition on our decrypted data. And the coolest thing about it all is that all of this could be executed using open source softwares while guaranteeing the privacy of data. However,
so far it's not efficient at all, so it's still a prototype, but people are making progress and research is making progress, and maybe in a few years we'll be able to do some to have some fully homomorphic encryption and to do some computation on encrypted data.
But you could use this homomorphic property, you can multiply all these ciphertexts together and end up with a number which represents the sum of all of the plaintext ballots.
If we have a shared secret, see if Alice and Bob can share a secret, they can use some symmetric cryptographic algorithms to establish secure communication.